Good day and welcome to this brief presentation at ISD Africa 2021, which is being held virtually this year because of COVID-19. My name is Maria Kate and I'm an associate professor with the Department of Computer Science at the University of Cape Town in South Africa. And I will present a discussion paper about natural language generation requirements for human-robot interaction for social robots in sub-Saharan Africa, which is placed in the next generation technologies track of the conference. I will commence with some motivation to then proceed to the objectives and the methodologies, after which the focus will shift to the results obtained from the two case studies, which are principally the NLG requirements for human-robot interactions for the social robots. I will close with conclusions and prospects. First and foremost, I consider social robots here, and thus not those in manufacturing plants and the ethics thereof with the jobs issues. So even so, with just social robots, there are different types of hardware and software that can be categorized as a robot, which a robot being a machine that carries out tasks or actions automatically that may or may not be human-like actions. Most of them are developed outside of Africa, and as a consequence, their responses and purposes can be applicable for our settings. For instance, Alexa uses the web to answer questions, but the web's content about Africa is limited and at times one-sided. Likewise, a major drive for care robots, or also called care bots, in the United States and Europe is to automate care for the elderly for assisted independent living, which has a lower priority with the median age of the population here in Africa and where the society has is less individualistic, basically. So the human robot interaction scenario is therefore then also maybe different because we are living in a different setting overall. So here you can see on the slide a hypothetical interaction example, just as illustration, combining a few salient components with a small learning assistance robot that you see on the right hand side. For one, there is the code switching, in this case between English and isiZulu, which is common in a multilingual society. Secondly, in an education setting, it may not be a one-to-one interaction between an individual learner and a robot, that is typically assumed, but it may be a one-to-many interaction with a group of learners, not unlike what you can see here when the learners share a textbook. So this brings us to the following questions, which are increasingly more specific. A broad general question is what it means for a robot to be programmed to be culturally aware. Slightly more specific is where they could assist humans rather than replace us. And narrowing down that further within assisting humans, what does that mean for the language technologies that the robots will have to be equipped with? Since this is still very broad, the specific question that the paper tries to report on is the state of the art in figuring out the unmet requirements for generating relevant personalized interaction, including text as precursor to speech. This translates into the main objective, which is to discuss robots as future-oriented technologies, availing of use cases that focus on the language they use for human-robot interaction, where the languages are those in the Niger-Congo B family of languages, formerly known as Bantu languages. And for purpose of understandability of the remainder of this presentation, however, most of the examples will be shown in English, but the references in the paper refer to the achievements with respect to the Niger-Congo B languages. So to meet that objective, I first contextualize robots and determine the respective human-robot interaction modes. Two use cases were selected and assessed in detail on current capabilities and needs so as to extract the requirements that will help plan a path forward. Social robots intend to provide services that make life easier. Sample scenarios identified for healthcare are remote primary healthcare to alleviate the low patient-doctor ratio and the language mismatch that frequently occurs between the home language of the doctor and that of the patient. For the education scenarios, the tasks identified are just as varied as internationally, such as for exercises and homework assistance, but perhaps more focused also on alleviating the burden imposed on teachers, especially in classes where there are like 50 to 100 learners that are hard to manage for a single teacher. There are many other options between those two usual suspects, such as for banking. Now there are those template-based controlled natural language text as you see there in the in contact, and SMS messages, and they are basically based on the controlled natural language, where you can see the value outlet and account, and they are variables where the values are slotted in. But further transaction information and interaction may be an option to increase financial literacy and hands-off interaction rather than just a one-way communication that we have now. Robots for physical distancing due to COVID borders on whether it might count as competing with humans for jobs, but that need not be the case. Those ones in the Rwanda you see on the left-hand side of the slides were acquired to protect their limited number of healthcare workers, and the room service robots you see on the right are deployed for the last few meters only, so as to serve travelers and other patrons with mild COVID who have to isolate and are isolating in a specific hotel. Overall, the type of robots, the mobile modes of interaction and contextualization narrows down NLG to the following five principal tasks and characteristics. There are the usual data to text and knowledge to text NLG topics. But a key new aspect is that the sentences to be generated have to be different from the type of sentences generated to date, being more conversational style sentences and more varied sentences based on the same data that is being verbalized. Multilingualism and code switching is a key requirement as well, and that taking into account the Niger-Congo-Bilan family of languages, because we're situated here in Africa. So what exactly does that mean for the typical natural language generation activities? It affects three key components in the conceptual pipeline. It affects first the text planning, or what is it that needs to be communicated, and in what order does it need to be communicated. Second, there is the lexicalization, that is the messages and the words. And third, where it affects it, is the linguistic realization, which has to be tailored to the Niger-Congo-B languages. Also, arguably, item 6 would need an additional sub-step, which is to evaluate whether the sentence is pronounceable, and possibly less so whether it is orthographically correct or not, because in the end you want to have the speech communication in most cases. All of the requirements, or those five key requirements, basically they span the NLG task spectrum. Well, this may sound like a lot. It actually already does include a substantial set of NLG problem areas, such as things that we don't really have to care about in the human-robot interaction scenario, is the figure-to-text, things like article summarization and controlled languages for business rules management. So what we have done here is already a scoping of the relevant NLG tasks for them. Let's then have a look at what is there and what do we still need. So to illustrate some of this in the limited time available for this presentation, I only touch upon the first case study about healthcare. What is currently available for context sensitive modifiable text generation, so no canned text that is manually translated, is the following, and in particular that is available for isiZulu and Runyankore. There is some structured knowledge in a localized version of SNOMED CT in OpenMRS, that's here there at the top, that takes the relevant template and verbalization algorithms and generates a still sentence. So for isiZulu and related languages, they actually are not simple templates, as you see there in the middle on the slide, but a pattern like this one, where there are multiple variables and the surface realization depends largely on the noun class of the noun and the phonological conditioning rules. what is needed are conversational sentences, like shown on the slide, in a snippet of the verification stage of the patient consultation. Clearly, there are more sentences involved, and it mixes data like patient 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with knowledge like the symptom of fever. This is not insurmountable, but it requires some additional work to be able to actually realize this. A basic version then of automatically generating CURT treatment instructions is also available, and in particular for Runya Koro, as I can sentences for a doctor's consultation. So for instance, the mobile Ishikosa app by Sadik Mula, and very recently AwezaMed has been launched, which takes it a little step further than the mobile Kosa by linking those canned sentences to a speech synthesizer for Afrikaans, isiZulu, and isiXhosa, which are the three most widely spoken home languages in South Africa. Both were developed to try to break down the language barrier on patient-doctor consultations in an attempt to improve the quality of healthcare services. Also here, there is a need for more interaction with friendlier instructions, conversational sentences, and interaction about the prescribed treatment with, say, a digital assistant, like shown on the slide. And flexible consultation sentences that are not only doctor-to-patient oriented, as is the case with the current tools, but also from the perspective of the patient to be able to communicate better to the doctor. Also, this would not be impossible to do, but certainly will require some extra more work. More precisely, the key requirements that the current state of the art cannot meet for the NCB languages, nor, in fact, for a number of much better resource languages, are the need for combining instance-level data with type-level knowledge, whose algorithms are otherwise typically kept separate in the systems. The tone of the sentences is different. And in particular, to have to be more polite and also be able to offer informal phrases and colloquial text intended for speech. This increases the demand for an even better management of an increased number of templates and therewith additional part of speech categories and verb tenses. It also makes dealing with numbers unavoidable in the sense of not writing saying guten, but properly spelled out, like imise, benzi, izi, ishumi, where the number is governed by the noun class of the noun that is being counted. And there is again the one-to-many interaction, the multilingualism and the code switching that we can't avoid. And that is also as illustrated in the introduction of this presentation. So to conclude, as there are indeed potential uses of social robots in sub-Saharan Africa that could assist society rather than be a threat to jobs or imperialism by other means. The uses identified are at least partially distinct from use case scenarios in the global north, such as assistance in large classes and remote primary healthcare. The human-robot interaction is expected to be both text and speech-based, and for it to function socially, it will need to have capabilities in Niger-Congo B languages. Other salient aspects are combining data to text with knowledge to text, different sentence styles and related grammar rules, and support for multiple languages. Well, there is some theory and techniques and proof of concept tools, and they need to be lined up, made openly available and adapted to be able to meet the requirements for NLG in the HRI with social robots. Finally, the outlook can be positive, which is not merely a case of techno-optimism. Societally, since it may offer a way out to the catch-22 of a skill shortage whilst respecting people's identity that is intertwined with one's language. Globally, the natural language generation aspects of human-robot interaction are fairly new, as is the notion of culturally aware robots. So rather than being passively at the receiving end as if it's all a fait accompli, we can join in the debate earlier, which may result in shaping the direction of its research and techniques in a way that we want to have it to be. The references here I listed here that I used in the slides. Thank you for your attention.